Ice Cube began his career as a truth teller. Starting out right here in South LA, he wrote lyrics about what he saw, and he pulled no punches. The stories he told and the images he evoked made people uncomfortable. Cube's music was raw and intense and brilliant. Ice Cube would ultimately go on to a solo career, but not really by himself. As he put down hit after hit, he collaborated with East and West Coast artists, exploring the joy, pain, and the risks of the Black community. In the course of his work, he sold millions of albums. Remember albums? And earned the respect of some of the greatest musicians to ever do it. But he didn't stop there. Ice Cube blew people away as an actor in Boys in the Hood. He went on to write, direct, produce films like Friday and Barbershop. The roles that he took and the stories he told changed the way we thought about what makes a successful show and what makes an authentic character. And Cube is still making moves. Most recently, he's been the force behind the Big Three Fireball League. And if you guys are not familiar with that, hopefully you'll learn a little bit during this conversation. And where is that fire coming from? Our culture, our soul, the very thing that Ice Cube has tapped throughout his career. Cube has changed the game because he saw possibilities that others didn't. He changed the game because he was willing to try the new, even when the old was working just fine. He changed the game because he made the world see him and his community the way he sees them. And for that, this award, the 2020 Game Changer Award, is the least that UCLA Anderson can do for him. It's my honor to share the 2020 UCLA Anderson Game Changer Award with one of LA's own, an innovator who embodies entrepreneurial thinking and passion in everything he does. And the first person I ever knew who went jacking for beats. Please join me as we honor the one and only Ice Cube.
Straight out of Compton, it's a crazy brother named Ice Cube. From the stupid dope gang with an attitude. When I'm caught up, I got a sword off. Kick knowledge and bodies on hold up. You too, boy, if you get with me. The police are gonna have to come and get me off your back. That's how I'm going out. Brothers ain't showing now, songs about to mumble. They wanna rumble. Mix them and cook them in a pot like gumbo. Going up on everybody like that. With bass, that's dropping in your face. So give it up smooth.
Joining Ice Cube for a fireside conversation, please welcome Jeff Morad, Chairman for Global Sports Industry Practice at Morgan Lewis and Center for Memes Board Member and Adjunct Professor at UCLA Anderson.
What's up, baby? How you doing?
See you, bro. Well, hello, everybody. Quite the crowd here. Yeah, Jay, you're right. They weren't here for you. But I know you're here for my friend, and, you know, congratulations. We're very excited to be able to give you the Game Changer Award this year, and I would say you deserve it for a career of interesting projects. So I started off, I made a few notes, and you know, this is pretty basic, but, you know, rapper, actor, producer, director, writer, entrepreneur. My gosh, I mean, that's a resume. No wonder your Wikipedia page is so long. you know, look, you've changed the game of music, film, and now making a heck of an impact in sports. And for all of that, I have terrific respect. But truly a game changer, and obviously that's why we're here. What I appreciate is that you're a proud LA guy.
Yeah, yay.
Grew up here. Tell us a little about where you came from.
South Central Los Angeles. You know, I grew up street called Van Wyck. And, you know, growing up on Van Wyck was great. We had a lot of kids in the neighborhood, so It was always something to do. It was always something to get into, so to speak. And, you know, we had fun. We fought, we played. You know, we experimented. We, you know, it was a lot going on, you know, from go-karts to dirt bikes to gang banging to, you know, football, basketball, baseball, you know, tag, hide and go seek. we just had fun, you know, and when I got my bike, I was really let loose because I can get all through the neighborhood real fast. So it was just, it was a playground to us growing up.
Nice.
Yeah.
And then you went to high school in the Valley?
Yeah, I actually started junior high. I went to Hughes Junior High in Woodland Hills. They closed that school down. actually, the principal told us we was the worst. When we was in the seventh grade, she actually said we were the worst seventh graders ever to go to this school. And then we went to the eighth grade. She had another assembly and said we were the worst eighth graders. So I don't know if she told that to every class, but next thing you know, they closed it down. We ended up going to another school, and I ended up going to Taft, which, damn, we got a tour door in the house? Okay, I feel you. Which was cool because it gave me a different perspective of L.A. You know, when I was younger, I didn't appreciate the new experience. You know, I was like, I wanted to go to the school in the neighborhood. And so, you know, as I got older, I realized that it opened me up to be able to communicate with all kind of people.
That's great.
Yeah.
That's great. You know, proud to have your parents here today.
Yeah.
One of your sisters, your wife.
Yes.
And of course, I'd be remiss if I didn't mention that both your parents worked at UCLA at one point in their career.
Yeah, yeah. Yes.
Thank you for coming back. So, Cube, let's talk. By the way, I tell people this all the time. When I first met Cube, you know, I asked him what I should call him. You know, like I kind of pulled my friends and my three sons, and they're like, well, you know, maybe it's Ice. Maybe it's Mr. Cube. And so I always make the point that I'm really not cool enough to call him Cube. I asked him what I should call him, and that's what he said. So,
yeah, if somebody called me Ice, they probably don't know me. You know, Cube is what all, you know, my friends call me Cube.
So just to answer that loaded question first, where'd the name come from?
My brother gave me that name.
And it stuck, boy.
Yeah, he's not wow. Here today. He's about 9 years older than me. And I was always trying to be cool. And we had a broke refrigerator on our block one time. It was like on the curb. They used to come pick him up. He was sit refrigerator on the curb. And I heard about a kid like dying in one of those. So I was always looking at it like, when are they gonna get this thing off our block? And one day he was just mad at me. He said, man, you know what? I'm gonna slam you in that refrigerator down the street. And when they pull your ass out, you're gonna be Ice Cube. So
there you go.
So I kinda was, you know, taking it as a badge of honor, you know? So I told all the homies, like, don't call me O'Shea no more. You know, it's Ice Cube. When I hit the block, it's Ice Cube. And it just stuck.
Oh, that's awesome. So let's talk career, starting with music. You obviously wrote a lot of lyrics. How'd that come about? Was it a natural thing for you? Did you force yourself to learn how to write lyrics?
Being a fan of hip hop, you know, a fan first, but even before that, you know, in school, I was always able to, you know, the teacher say, what'd you do for summer vacation? I was always able to put my thoughts on paper, you know, and, I would get rewarded for that. And so I guess it was always something in me where I was able to, you know, take my experiences, put them on paper for people to read them, check them out, understand what's going on. And so, you know, when hip hop came along and I wasn't even thinking about rapping, you know, one of my friends, and I was in eighth grade, one of my friends named Kiddo, we were in typing class, typing class, the actual typewriters. And I hated the class because I thought I should be in a different elective, but I took a long time to meet with my counselor, so all they had left was typing. So long story short, he asked me, yo, you ever write a rap before? We had time, we wasn't doing nothing. And I was like, no. He's like, okay, you write one, I write one, we see which one's the best. So I started writing and never stopped, you know, from then on.
And
you know,
the rest is history.
Rest is history, for real. Yeah.
That's awesome. So those early years with NWA, you know, taught you a lot, I assume, about the music business.
Yes.
Some good, some not. What were those years like? And how do they compare to what the way you see the business today?
Oh, those years, they were fun. You know, being able to, first of all, we thought we were going to be locals forever. You know, we thought the professional rappers came from New York and everybody else was locals. So that's what we thought was going to be our plight. We just going to do raps for each other damn near, you know, for the neighborhood, you know. I know if they don't like me in New York, they'll like me on Cullivan, or they'll like me on Ruth Ellen, or they'll like me in my neighborhood. You see what I mean? And so that was our goal. And it just started to take off and blow up and get bigger. And what it is, we were true to ourselves. So the world recognized that. And if we wasn't, if we were trying to be like the New York rappers, I wouldn't be sitting here today.
So the business itself, that was an education?
Yes.
And, you know, tell us the good, the bad, and the ugly, or whatever you can do in a minute or two.
Well, music is fun till money get involved in it. You know, it's all fun till somebody gets a check. And then it's like, well, wait a minute. Well, how did he get that? And where's mine? And so now everybody start to realize there's a business up under this thing called show business. And you either adapt real fast and figure it out, or you will be taken advantage of. And the worst thing I've seen is people sign their publishing away and at young ages for peanuts. And you know, it's a lot of salmon swimming upstream in the industry,
right,
as artists.
Right.
But it's a lot of grizzly bears standing on the side.
That's a good line.
Waiting to pluck you and eat you.
Yeah.
So be careful.
Yeah. Those are wise words. So, you know, truly you fundamentally changed the way, you know, people thought about hip hop. When that was happening, were you aware of it? Were you aware of the impact that you were making across the country?
Oh, yeah. You know, when you got people like C. Dolores Tucker and Tipper Gore and, you know, some of the, you know, most powerful people in the country at the time coming after your music and the way you do things and your creative process and your truth, it makes you mature real quick. You realize, you know, how much power you have in the music, in the lyrics, and how much power the truth has, you know, even if it's your truth, you know, it has a lot of power, if, you know, but you definitely should make sure that you have the thick skin enough to handle, you know, the arrows that come back at you when you tell your truth.
Yeah.
You know, a lot of people don't want to hear it, and that don't mean you don't tell it. So, you know, we learned we learn to have, you know, a lot of courage along the way, because we realize, like, we know what we're saying is real and true. And if people are opposing that, they're wrong and they can't win.
Great. So you transitioned to acting.
Yes.
How'd that happen?
I was discovered, you know, by a guy named John Singleton. Rest in peace. John, he was a guy who, you know, knew exactly what he wanted. He saw something in me that I didn't even see in myself. You know, I never thought about acting at all. I always thought it was something you had to be, you know, trained to do. Like, you had to go to Juilliard. You had to go to Juilliard, you know what I mean, to be an actor. So that's all I was thinking in my mind. You know, I'm not qualified, but he believed in me more than I believed at the time that I could do it. I trusted him, and we took a ride with a movie called Boys in the Hood that I'll never forget. A movie that I first went to the Cannes Film Festival. You know, the first movie I'm ever in gets nominated for Oscar, and you know, you just can't beat that. I got bit by the bug and started to write and produce and direct and, you know, just become part of the industry.
And was it a natural transition to the other parts of the entertainment business? You know, producing, directing?
Yeah, totally. You know, after I did Boys in the Hood, he told me, he looked at me, he was like, actually, we were actually still shooting the movie. We were just in the process of, you know, shooting it and getting it cut and all that. And I was in his house one day and he said, when you gonna write a movie? And I'm like, what, John? I'm just now acting in a movie. Now you asking me to write one? I mean, I'm not qualified for this. He said, man, you think all the scripts you get gonna be as good as Boys in the Hood? He said, man, you might not never do another movie again if you wait for Hollywood. So I started thinking, he said, man, if you can write a song that vivid, you can write a script and I'm gonna help you.
That's great.
He helped me walk through it. Me and my wife, Kim, it was a Apple store or something, Macintosh store or something on Santa Monica Boulevard. We rolled up in there, grabbed a Mac, I'm grabbing programs, and I started writing that day. And my first couple of scripts were terrible, but my third one was Friday, which was a good, yeah, good third script. Thank you.
Nice. So talk about Straight Outta Compton.
Yeah.
What was it like working with your son? What was it like seeing your life play out in front of you like it did?
It was incredible at times, you know, stressful at other times. You know, seeing my son, you know, play me, I was extremely impressed by him and his commitment to acting and to the process. You know, acting, it's a lot of hurry up and wait, you know, sitting around, not a lot going on until there's something going on. So for him to stick with that process for over 2 years and actually do it, you know, it's like watching your kid up on a high wire. You know, you're proud and scared at the same time.
Right.
You just want him to be successful and want it to come out all right. And the project was a monster to do. You know, I was totally unreasonable doing that project just because it's our story, you know, and you give an inch and somebody will have you looking stupid up there on that screen. So, you know, we pulled and fought and, you know, even me and Dre put in some of our own money to make sure that movie was right. And that's what you got to do sometimes. You got to be passionate about what you're working on. It can't just be a money play.
Yeah.
I knew this was history. I knew, you know, this movie could possibly be around longer than me, possibly.
It may be. It may be.
But so we got to do it right, and we can't take no for an answer.
So is there a project that is most special to you? Is it Straight out of Compton? Is it another project? Let's leave Big Three for the next part of the discussion, but...
I mean, it's... All of them are precious, man. You know, Jeff, it's so hard to get a movie made out here and to get promoted and marketed the right way and accept it, you know? So whenever you do a project like that and people love it and look at it over and over and learn from it and, you know, but that's been, you know, Straight Outta Compton, that's been, you know, Friday, Boys in the Hood, Ride Along, Are We There Yet? You know, which, you know, I'm very proud of Are We There Yet? Because, you know, black kids don't get movies like that. You know, they don't really get a big budget kids movie. And so I was happy to do that. I did Anaconda because... I did it for one reason. I didn't die in the movie. And I got a chance to kill the snake.
That's
so
awesome.
Me and Jennifer Lopez, we were saying, damn, can you believe we get to kill the snake to star? Yeah, so it's kind of funny.
That's awesome. So when I was growing up, and many in the room were, and you, the voice of God, as they called him, was John Facenda,
yeah.
Who was you know, the guy who narrated all the NFL film projects. And, you know, whenever there was a sports project, it seems that it was John Facenda.
Yes.
Well, he's now passed away. And today, it's Cube. Everywhere I turn, whether it's cartoons or video games or, you know, documentaries on Muhammad Ali or documentaries on the NFL or Major League Baseball, it's Cube doing the voiceover. It's like that's a career in and of itself. And it's fascinating to me. And I'm just curious to know how you feel about hearing your voice kind of wherever you turn.
I mean, I love it. It's fun. I'm not that on my own tip, but I love it. It's fun because I love sports, and I, you know, I'm definitely into cartoons and video games, and, you know, everything that entertainment has to give, you know, I can always see myself doing a piece of that or a part of that. And, you know, it's cool to be around long enough to have a recognizable voice.
Yeah.
And, you know, I'm not mad at it at all, you know, that people can recognize my voice. And now they're asking me to do voiceovers. I did one that was great for Reggie Jackson. I did one for the Lakers versus the Celtics on ESPN. So I enjoy it, you know. I do it all the time for the Big Three. So oh,
that's great.
Yeah, it's very fun.
No, it's fun. It is a fun part of your career, I'm sure. So let's talk sports. You're an LA guy, Raiders fan, Dodgers fan,
Lakers.
At least I think Lakers too.
Yes.
And you wear that LA a lot.
Yeah.
All different colors. It's kind of cool.
You know, I got to represent. You know, that's why I got to represent. And, you know, I love L.A. You know, I think I've been all over the world, and there's no place I'd rather be than Los Angeles. I think it has everything anybody can want. One of my friends from Texas, he loves just coming to L.A. and driving around, you know, which is weird because this is, you know, but he's like, man, you got so many hills and mountains and trees. It's like a damn amusement park. It's like riding around Disneyland, but the whole city. And so it's kind of cool. You know, sometimes when you're here, you don't look around. You don't kind of see what's so great about L.A., but it's a lot of great stuff about this town.
Well, that's great. You certainly represent the city proudly. So let's talk Big Three.
Yeah.
on your hat, on your shirt, and it's a big part of your life. Talk about the origins of it. Where, how did it come about, and how did you come up with the idea?
Just as a fan. We grew up, you know, my mother and father backyard, playing a lot of 3-on-3 basketball, running into the garage, tearing it up. You know, it's like, I remember them saying, okay, it's 10 o'clock, y'all, 11 o'clock, no more bouncing of that ball. So, but we used to battle. You know, our battles were, you know, in that backyard were as strong as any championship battle you would see in the NBA. So, serious as a heart attack. And so I grew up loving the game. And I never understood why 3-on-3 was never elevated to the professional level. You know, you got this Mountain Dew stuff, you know what I mean? They do outside, they do Nike, they do it outside the arena. Weekend Warriors, you know, not pros, you know, just me and you can go out there and get a team going. So I was like, this stuff should be in the arena. And so thinking of that, talking with my partner, Jeff Quantness, who's, you know, me and him, we're like mad scientists. We just brainstorm all day and talk about what we can create, what's cool, what we can do to be ahead of the curve. And so it was the big three, you know, elevating 3-on-3 basketball to the professional level and creating this experience, you know. 6 games for the price of 1. You know, former NBA players, you know, going at it half court, no time clock, game to 50. So there's no garbage minutes because there's no minutes. 4-point shot, just make it cool. You know, have entertainers come, make it loose where, you know, we had a kid run and get an autograph from Dr. J in the middle of a game.
Is that right?
So why not? You know what I mean? Yeah. Why, you know, be all stuffy and stale and, so we wanted to create a new experience, and it's the big three. It's the most satisfying project I've ever done, but it's the hardest as well. It's the hardest
thing. So we're going to talk about some of those challenges, but before we do that, we have a video that we're going to show. A little bit of a surprise.
Yo, Q. Oh. Congratulations on receiving this award and the recognition you deserve for the things you have accomplished, not as an artist, but as a businessman. Back in the 70s, when we released the Parliament albums, they had a theme that said, what we had in us was greater than a system that was designed to hold us back. It is rewarding to know that a young man took hold of that notion and used it to propel himself to unimaginable places and new heights. Every playing field you stepped on, you changed the game, from music to film, even professional basketball. I have no doubt that whatever you are led to next, you will continue to tear the roof off. Congratulations, Uncle George.
Amen.
You know.
George Clinton, if it wasn't for him, like I said, I wouldn't be here. Like, George Clinton showed us how to do it, how to be yourself, how not to conform. Everything is funky. And you know, I remember my sister taking me down to VIP Records, I believe it was called, in the shopping center down on Crenshaw and Imperial to see George. Back in the 80s, or late 70s, early 80s. And that group blew my mind. And so to be able to work with him and to be able to just have him acknowledge what we're doing is just, it's a great thing because he's one of my favorite artists of all time.
Yeah, that's awesome.
Yeah.
So back to Big Three. So Jeff Quatnitz and you spearhead the project. What are some of the challenges that you've come across? You referenced, not always easy.
Yeah. Well, you know, people laugh at you when you've come up with an idea that's never existed. You know, first they laugh at you, Then they ignore you. Then they ask for a meeting. Then they beg for a meeting. So that's the process, man. You know, we got laughed at. You know, they're in the process now of asking for meetings. So, you know, we're close. And it's been hard, you know. A lot of people don't invest in sports because it's hard for a league to work. You know, the last league that's really worked was UFC. That's 20 years ago when it started. So, you know, we were really, you know, going against the grain, going uphill. But we believed in this concept, this idea. We believed in the time frame. You know, there was a void in the industry when it comes to summer. And me, in the summer, I like basketball, I like football. So I hibernate in the summer, you know? And I have people wake me up in September when football come back around, you know? So, but now you don't have to do that. You got the big three, you know, 10 weeks of a competitive league that makes the summer cool again when it comes to sports. And so, you know, we knew it would be hard. We're glad people are coming to the party, you know, even if they're showing up a little late. That's okay.
That's great. You know, well, you're starting your fourth season.
Yes.
And we all wish you a lot of luck this year, for sure. So talk to us about leadership. What's your leadership style, and where'd you learn it?
You know, I think as a leader, first thing you got to do is be honest with yourself and realize what you don't know. You know, it's always easy to figure out what you know, but sometimes ego won't let you admit what you don't know. So I've always, you know, wanted to find people that were great at what they do and give them the room to shine, to do it, to give their input and ideas. And as long as they work as hard as me, you know, as long as they don't take no shorts, because I can't take no shorts. I gotta be on, and it has to be right. So I expect everybody to be on and right, and I'll let you shine. And I'll let you show me what you got. And I'll help you, and I feel like I'm a supportive leader. I'm not looking to cut the people who work for me down or embarrass them or, you know, treat them like anything less than a man or woman. And, you know, I think you can get a lot done with that method. You know, you don't have to be a yeller, you know, a guy who's always mad. You don't have to have the whole company scared of you. All that kind of stuff that happens, you know. You can be cool, pleasant person who is down for your business, and everybody, you know, will respect that. Long as you are fair and direct in your, you know, discipline or criticism, or, you know, people will respect. We respect that. You don't have to intimidate and do any of those kind of things to get it done.
That's great. It's a collaborative style.
It's all collaborative, you know. Yeah. And everybody's grown, and, you know, people work for me, but they actually work for themselves. You know, they really want, you know, to provide for their family. So, you know, I don't get what's called jack in the box when it comes to that. Yeah. You know, which is the big head.
Yeah.
So, you know.
That's great. So you know, the Game Changer Award, which you're given today, is an award for those who have changed the space that they're involved with. You've done that multiple times in multiple spaces, but you've never forgotten the community you came from. And that's something that I know I respect, and a lot of people in the world respect that as well. And you know, how do you demonstrate that commitment? Do you, you know, how do you encourage those who are in similar positions that you were back in the day and help them move forward?
I mean, I try to be a good example that you can be yourself and still get ahead. You know, you want to grow, but you don't want to forget what you know. You know, where I come from helps me in business. It gives me an edge, and I appreciate it, and I use it, and I'm not ashamed of it. And I hope I'm an example for you know, anybody from every community, not just mine, that, you know, the status quo is a bad word, and you got to be a game changer. We can't leave it like it is, man. We gotta change this.
Well, best of luck continuing to do that. Let's hear it for Ice Cube.
Thank you.
UCLA. Congratulations.